Dear friends, I would like, first of all, to thank the Freie Universität Berlin and to also especially Professor Miltos Pachlivanos for this kind invitation. I am going to speak in English, since I haven't used German for a lot of years. Sie mögen mir aber glauben, auf Deutsch, diesen Vortrag dem Andenken eines mutigen Menschen zu widmen. Dem Andenken meines Professors an der Wiener Universität, Gunnar Hering, der mit allen Kräften gegen die griechische Diktatur gekämpft hat. More than 40 years after the coup d'etat on the 21st of April 1967, a systematic study of the dictatorship has become necessary, both historically and politically. Of course, many interesting papers have been written about that period, and the number is adequate enough. The body of text available to the researcher is now extensive, particularly in the sphere of testimony from chronicles to literature. There are fewer historiographical and other studies, on the other hand, and they are focused on issues of political and social circumstances. The student movement, the foreign factor, the ways by which people fought against the new order. As usually occurs with unpopular regimes, the analysis of the structures of the state under the junta has made little to no progress. Studies on the establishment of the regime, the conditions that allowed it, the nature of the dictatorship, its pillars, the army, the church, specific social groups, and essays on its ideology and its effect on the broader social classes are absent. The research tends to focus on the discontinuities and the antitheses, and not on the successions and continuities in specific aspects of domestic and foreign policy. Despite the recognition of the dictatorship importance in recent... Despite the recognition of the dictatorship importance in recent Greek history and the accumulation of new questions and evidence of the regime and the resistance against it, with few exceptions, new fully explanatory interpretations that differ from those firstly highly expressed in the 70s, in the heat of the moment, have not been proposed. Despite the constant accretion of literature on the regime and the resistance in Greece, there is one phenomenon unique in the whole course of Greek 20th century which remains uncharted, the anti-dictatorial movement abroad. I call it unique because it was the first time in modern Greek history that saw such a widespread and wide-ranging movement of sympathy against the junta in Greece. The movement originated with Greeks who happened to be abroad at the time, but it gained support from a wide-spanning, diverse set of non-Greeks, ranging from conservative philologists of ancient Greek to left-wing citizens and anarchists, all of whom were connected by their common love for Greece and their opposition to tyranny. What were their participants? What networks did they form? What relations did they have to the resistance with Greece? Such questions have received very little attention in the studies. Written testimonies are scarce, systematic studies even fewer. An important mass of documents have accumulated in various archives in recent years, but a huge amount of material is still in private hands, not available to historical research. The majority of available documents are primarily about France, as this was by happenstance the location of a number of well-known intellectuals who later played a significant role in Greek political and cultural life following the Μεταπολίτευση, as the period following the end of the junta is known. By contrast, the movement in opposing the junta in Germany, a country which, in my view, was the locomotive of Greek resistance in Europe, remains virtually unknown. West Germany, for instance, hosted the most numerous and more massive anti-junta organizations across the political spectrum, with extensive actions and a considerable impact on German international public opinion. The factors that contributed to this can be easily identified. The huge number of Greek economic immigrants in the country, the population of active Greek students, and a group of Greek scientists with important connections to German society. On a second level, many German citizens and institutions, parties, churches, trade unions, were active in demonstrating their sympathy in a European country with important bearing on the international scene, and institutions such as the European Economic Community and NATO. I will try then to make some comments on an uncharted, as I already mentioned, field. The 1960 bilateral recruitment agreement unfurled a huge wave of immigration from Greece to Germany, which subsided temporarily during the economic crisis of 1966 to 1967. In 1967, approximately 350,000 Greek workers, men and women, were estimated to be living in West Germany. They were young, poorly educated, and coming mostly from rural areas. They soon set up communities with important networks between them and German society, political, religious, and trade union associations. From the first moment after the 1967 coup d'etat, these networks played an important role in informing German public opinion and supporting the Greek resistance, as was reflected in the massive protests of Greeks and Germans immediately following the 21st of April. I mentioned that Greek immigrants did not take long in organizing themselves. Among other things, this was due to an important extent to the local organizations of Greek political parties, which had been keenly interested in these potential voters in the years preceding the agenda. Greek political organizations had already been created in the German cities with the largest concentrations of Greeks already before the dictatorship. The most influential and well-organized political power amongst the immigrants was on the left. I would like to remind you that the Communist Party was illegal in Greece after the Civil War. The legal expression of the left was the Unified Democratic Left Party, EDA. EDA and also its youth organization called Labrakis Democratic Youth were quite massive in Germany. Another organization with an important number of immigrants among its ranks was the Center Union, Enosikedru, the party that aimed to occupy the political space between right and left. During the junta, the existing resistance mechanism did not remain unaffected. On the contrary, they were deeply influenced by developments on the Greek political scene. Let me know two important events that took place 1 year after the coup d'etat in 1968. The split in the Communist Party of Greece, with Communist Party of Interior, and the founding of the Pan-Hellenic Liberation Movement, PAK, by Andreas Papandreou. Both were decisive for a rearrangement of Greek political affiliation in Germany, resulting in breakups and withdrawals. A case apart are the parties and organizations emerging after the split of the Communist Party, all those in May 68, echoing the radical political ideas of youth movements and the ambience of the 60s. Among them, the revolutionary communist movement of Greece, EKE, holds a central position. It was founded at the beginning of the 70s in Berlin. Overall, Greek political parties in Germany kept an open channel of communication with like-minded German formations, seeking their support and defending the cause against the dictatorship. Apart from the Greek political parties, in Germany were also formed organizations by Greek anti-dictatorial groups that were active in Greece, such as the Pan-Hellenic Anti-Dictatorial Front, PAM, or Democratic Defense, Dimokratiamina, closely associated with the Greek political scene. A separate chapter consists of the anti-dictatorial action of Greek students who either moved to Germany from Greece for graduate or progress or postgraduate studies, or who enrolled in German universities as the sons and daughters of immigrants. Following the example of their German peers, they organized themselves in primary level associations and set up their higher level organization, the Federation of Greek Student Unions of West Germany and West Berlin. Greek students and their organizations attempted to place the Greek issue at the center of the demands and mobilization of the student movements in the countries in which they were staying. Through the activities of their associations, publishing magazines, organizing protests, press conferences and concerts, often in collaboration with politicians, union members, social institutions, the students fought the gender. Many of these students became members of revolutionary left organization after May 68. West Germany was a preferred study destination for Greeks starting from the earliest year of the newly formed Greek state in the 9th century with the support of the Bavarian dynasty. Although the connections withered significantly after World War II, an important number of Greeks attended German university during the 50s and the 60s in areas such as law and literature, and some remained in the country to pursue professional careers. When the Junta seized power, anti-regime Greeks returned to the country where they studied and set up powerful groups to bring pressure to bear on German politicians for an international denunciation of the Greek Junta. Their knowledge of the way the public sphere worked in Germany contributed to their success. In Germany, as in the rest of Europe, a series of societies and movements from Greeks and Germans were formed, aiming to play an important role in solidarity with the Greek people. These associations attempted and managed to contribute to informing and influencing public opinion, organizing events and concerts, also publishing agitatorial material and financing the resistance group. A further study of their synthesis and their activities will provide important information for these parts of the German society sensitized by the Greek struggle. All these groups operated on different levels, aiming both at influencing a domestic German audience as well as opposing military rule in Greece. In Germany, actions were primarily aimed at keeping public opinion updated with what was happening in Greece, building up a powerful discourse to counter the Junta's propaganda. The goal was the international isolation of the military regime, denunciations of torture in Greece, list with thousands of political prisoners, and information about resistance activity inside the country, all silenced by the Junta, were publicized internationally thanks to the networks of Greek abroad around the world, with great impact on public opinion. Developments, such as the de facto suspension of the accession agreement to the European Economic Community, the eviction of the Junta from the Council of Europe in 1969, and the arms embargo against the Greek state, were also due to indefatigable denunciation in international fora and to pressure exerted by Greeks abroad. This pressure was brought to bear in multiple ways on different levels. They were constant appeals to the German government and German political parties, and denunciation to international organizations, as well as massive manifestations, concerts, and protests with thousands of Germans participating. The bloodshed of the 17th of November 1973 caused a wave of protests which began a few hours after the invasion of the Athens Polytechnic University by tanks and only ended a few months later. Journals such as Greeks Documentum and Informationen played a key role in revealing the atrocities of the Junta. In the direction of informing the Greek immigrants on the one hand and setting aside public opinion on the other, a very important role was also played by the special radio programs from Greek immigrants in Deutsche Welle and in the Bavarian radio. German territory offered a hospitable refuge to many anti-regime Greeks who found shelter and employment there. The case of Georgios Alexandros Magakis is exemplary. Having studied law in Germany, Magakis was teaching as an associated professor at the Law School of Athens, where he was fired by the dictatorial regime. He was also arrested for his anti-dictatorial activity. In 1972, while he was in prison, the University of Heidelberg appointed him as a professor. After strong pressure from international public opinion, Magakis was released from prison for health reasons and was able to resettle in Heidelberg. Greek dictatorial organization abroad supported the Greek resistance, offering economic assistance and lending an international dimension to the national struggle. Let us note, for instance, the mediation of George Vukelatos Democracy Group, Ομάδα Δημοκρατία, in inviting, Professor Maronitsi has already told us, the well-known German intellectual and author Gitten Grass to visit Greece and participate in an event organized by the Anti-Regime Society for studying Greek problems. There was a constant flow of persons and events between Greeks and Germany, from propaganda leaflets against the Germany to material for dynamic action against the regime. An important part of the dictatorial action consists in protecting Greek emigrants and students in the host country. The military rulers in Athens seem to be indifferent to anti-regime activity in other European countries, but in Germany, due to the large number of Greek emigrants, they tried to interfere. They attempted to gain support by organizing events and offering aid and funds, and also to intimidate Greeks in Germany, mainly through consular authorities, threatening to revoke their citizenship or ban entry to Greece, or making threats against family who had remained in the country. Resistance organizations responded to such attempts with continuing denunciations to the German government and public opinion campaigns, and to a large extent, they obtained protection. The anti-dictatorial movement in Germany could not have succeeded without the support of German public opinion, which proved very sensitive to the Greek cause. In a decade of flourishing social movements, the military rule in Greece was seen by many as yet another bastion of tyranny and authoritarianism in a global struggle spanning from Vietnam and Chile to the Iberian Peninsula. For some, Greece symbolized the birthplace of democracy due to its history. The demand that Germany denounce the Greek regime was linked with Germany's own broader foreign policy and the need, 22 years after the end of the World War II, to act as a defender of democracy and freedom. Let us recall the hunger strike of the German Neo-Hellenist Gunnar Hering in December 1969, demanding that Germany condemn Greece at the Council of Europe. But it was not just the support of ordinary people. Thanks to the mobilization of Greeks in Germany, the Greek cause found sympathy in many institutions, first and foremost in the German political parties. Of special importance in this respect is the present action of the SPD, which, allow me to recall, came to office in 1969 with Willy Brandt, at one of the most significant moments for the history and status of German social democracy. Although Germany, like the other European countries, never broke off its relations with the military junta, the SPD's positive stance vis-à-vis Greek anti-regime forces play a determined role in terms of any kind of support to the struggle against the dictatorship. This policy was not always unanimous or unitary, especially in regard to issues of governmental policy and diverging different interests and strategies. In this context, anti-regime Greeks played a key role as a pressure group, unrelenting in their demand to condemn the junta. Valuable help to the Greek resistance came from German trade union, whose ranks comprised Greek immigrants under the applicable bilateral recruitment agreement. Trade unions helped the Greek cause in many ways, offering economic assistance and aid. For Greek workers in Industrial Union of Metal, for example, population of approximately 90,000 people, as estimated on the basis of trade union membership, there was a special newspaper edition in Greek with information about the situation in Greece in a distinctly dictatorial tone. Another important institution in favor of the Greek struggle was the Evangelical Church, which accorded special care to immigrants. I could mention many other institutions, but I won't. It is a vast territory, still uncharted, but extremely important for the history of Greek-German relations. One last remark. Contrary to what some would like to believe, the dictatorial struggle in Germany was not one united and without internal problems. This is not to say that there were no common actions or efforts to form alliances and to cooperate, which is to be seen all across the dictatorial front. In fact, there was important opposition and dissent, which often led to conflicts with withdrawals and breakups, mutual association and finger pointing. Issues such as whether the struggle should be offensive or passive, or what should be the movement's attitude towards the attempted liberalizations of the regime in Athens, caused many debates and friction among and inside the dictatorial groups. Even if many of the pages of this story are sad, on the other hand, they are totally normal. Think of the deep ideological and political differences that separated all these groups who came together in order to serve a common goal, that of overthrowing the regime. Indeed, for many of these groups, overthrowing the junta was the first step in the subversion of the political system itself. I have alluded to the explanatory character of the dictatorial movement, especially in Germany. Allow me to dwell a little longer on it. It is high time that German and Greek scholars and institutions took steps before precious sources are lost forever. We arguably need a program of oral history here in Greece to systematically collect testimonies from Greek and German subjects about their participation in their dictatorial movement. Important work has been accomplished by George Mazuranis with his books, but clearly this is not enough. On the other hand, it's vital to bring together archival material for public records, political parties and agencies, and from physical persons too. Already at the Contemporary Social History Archives, we have proceeded to assemble the majority of personal records and collections on the struggle against the agenda in Germany, and many of these documents are freely accessible on the internet. In addition to the collected material, compilation for people who were active in Germany can be found in the Historical Archive of the Benaki Museum, the Society for the Study of the History of Left-Wing Youth, the Parliamentary Library in Greece, etc. Tribute must be paid to important private initiatives for bringing together documents, such as Athanasios Miriodis for Central Union Hellenic Democratic Youth. It is important, however, to bring into the public domain collections and archives currently in the hands of individuals and agencies, especially in Germany. Today, digitalization allows the reproduction of archival documents, which can then be made available to research, property, cross-checked, and verified. I would like to focus on a specific example so as to show how important the collection and elaboration of this kind of material is for understanding the dictatorial struggle. I refer to a special part of the movement, that of the dictatorial press. On the Contemporary Social History Archives, we are bringing together titles and printed matter from all over the world, from all the places where people oppose the junta under a relatively large-scale project. This material covers a wide geographical span, stretching from Sweden and Hungary to Canada, focusing on Western Europe and the United States. It is published in many languages and covers the entire Greek political spectrum from the Royalist right to the revolutionary left. So far, we have assembled 500 titles from all over the world. First of all, it is evident that the majority of this material was published in West Germany, an impressive number of titles, 60, with France following, as you can see on this chart. Most of the material in West Germany is published in the Greek language, unlike in other European countries like France or the United Kingdom, where French and English respectively are very present. The reasons are obvious and have to do with the presence of Greek emigrants. Typical in this respect is the dissemination of the places of publication throughout Germany, where Greek emigrants had settled and where material against the agenda was published. In contrast to other countries where such material was published by resistance committees and organizations, in West Germany it was Greek political parties and movements who issued the material, followed by resistance organizations while a considerable part was published by trade unions and by movements that supported the anti-dictatorial struggle. Let us also note the difference in the political affiliation of publishers. Whilst in other European countries, the left, especially what would not always be called revolutionary left, is very conspicuous, in Germany, the center is strongly present. The press affords a better understanding of the character and the differences between resistance groups. The press, however, should be seen as much more than a mere recording of activity or a valuable source for understanding human networks. It is also a privileged field of communication and interaction between different authors and readerships. The final outlook of the material is molded by constant osmosis. Greek emigrants in West Germany are transformed as they read these pages that address them as a separate category of workers with their own problems in the host country. It is a new type of citizens who must now, from their new place, stand up against an authoritarian regime of which they lack first-hand experience. The force of this material in forging immigrants' views is impressive. Let us not forget that the dictatorship occurred at a turning point in the history of Greece. Immigration and urbanization, mostly towards Athens, signaled to a great extent the end of a traditional way of life, the dismantling of all hierarchies and corrections. Social strata traditionally not traveling found themselves in totally unknown new destinations and became part of a new world despite the hardships. For instance, albeit fearing and mistrusting trade union representation, workers were almost forced to join labor unions which cared about protecting their rights. For example, 150,000 Greeks are estimated to have joined German trade unions, a rate which even exceeds Germans. Young immigrants, men and women, became recipients of multiple information and stimuli inevitably leading them to constantly make comparisons. Comparisons between old and new, tied up with information that made them long for change. In this context, and in the light of their new experiences, Greek emigrants in Germany and Western Europe in general took a negative stance to military rule. Their dream of returning to the homeland was accompanied by a wish for normalcy in political life, by the demand to live in a country not constantly in state of emergency. Their new living conditions enabled them to express this attitude. Not everybody, not in the same form. But even if they did not manifest against the agenda, few Greek immigrants in Europe lent open support to it. All in all, the discussion about the dictatorial struggle in Germany cannot be separated from the experience of immigration and the way the latter was embedded in the change of the 60s. Let us recall that increasingly in recent years, the dictatorship is seen as the moment of crisis between the post-Civil War regime as constructed in the 50s, and the new forces liberated in the 60s. So on the whole, it is possible to argue now that just as the dictatorship itself, so too the dictatorial struggle abroad signaled the end of the period starting immediately after the Civil War, whose marks were deeply engraved on Greek society. This is not a Greek phenomenon. It is part of what Huntington calls the third wave of democratization and includes the transition from dictatorship to democracy in Spain and Portugal. In these traditions, Greeks abroad, living in an environment of tremendous change and an explosive demand for democracy, developed stronger feelings in regard to the military junta. In fact, the central question which dominates their discussions only takes reading through the page of the anti-regime press or their personal correspondence or learning about their meetings, was what would happen the day after, what would be the political stage of the change of polity. Because this, I think, how we should ultimately read the dictatorial struggle in Germany, aside from its heroic nature, as a big laboratory for all Greek political forces, a laboratory of fermenting ideas, a meeting point for people having arrived from different, opposite political paths, forced out of the traumas of the 40s to join forces against each other. The debate inside Greece, where most of them converged as soon as the junta collapsed, was from the start forward-looking and was dominated by differences, conflicted pursuits, oppositions. Today, 40 years later, at the end perhaps of the period that we call μεταπολίτευση, we meet again to discuss a new future. Let us revisit the dictatorial struggle and everything that happened back then as an experience that can, all things considered, yield arguments and thoughts about today.
Thank you very much, Mr. Karamanoulakis, for your very interesting and interesting and rich lecture. Although we don't have a lot of time to go into detail, I would like to ask you something about the aftermath of this very interesting history. In the end of your lecture, you called the common Greek-German action a laboratory of fermenting ideas. And do we know anything about the use of these ideas? I mean, was there any use of, organizational structures or the contact with the public opinion in Germany after the removal of the junta?
This is a very nice question, but also very difficult to answer. First of all, when I spoke about laboratory, I mean this process. Process of forming a common culture of coexistence between the political parties. Now, I'm not sure, I couldn't answer to your question. I'm thinking about this idea, the idea of fermenting ideas, that the key decade is the decade of 80s. I would like to remind you that a lot of people from the political personnel, especially in the decade of 80s, had studied in Germany. Also, I want to make a distinction between the political personnel and also the immigrants. I think the Greek economic immigrants. I think that the experiences of Greek economic immigrants in Germany is something very important for them, that they carried them when they came back, also in 80s, more than in this.
Thank you.